Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome. My name is Laurie Piercy, and I am Associate Vice President here at the Chinese University of Hong Kong, and I'm delighted to moderate this afternoon's lecture. And it is my great pleasure to introduce our speaker this afternoon, Professor Carlos Low from the Department of Government and Public Administration, to deliver a lecture on national corporate sustainability security, which forms a part of the CUHK lecture series on national security, the bigger picture. And I'd note that we are 48 hours away from the commencement of this year's National Security Education Day on the 15th. Professor Carlos Low is well known to many across the CUHK community, and so I'll be brief in my introductory remarks because I know that perhaps he needs no introduction, but he nonetheless has an impressive CV. Professor Carlos Low is currently a professor and head of the Department of Government and Public Administration, and he is also the director of the Center for Business Sustainability. Professor Low obtained his PhD from Flinders University in South Australia in 1990 and received a Doctor of Law from the Renmin University of China in 2001. His research interests focus on the areas of law and government, environmental management, public sector, and corporate social and environmental responsibility within the contexts of Greater China and, of course, Hong Kong. He's dedicated to promoting CSR as a progressive business model that permits corporations and SMEs to achieve business sustainability through the launch and compilation of the flagship Business Sustainability Index, covering SMEs in Hong Kong and listed companies here across the broader Greater Bay Area and, of course, around China. Recently, Professor Low has been offering consultancy services and he's organized management training programs across the public and private sectors. Ladies and gentlemen, those of you with us here in Choyo Hall and those of you who are joining us online, please join us in welcoming Professor Low to deliver a lecture on national corporate sustainability security. Professor Low, please. Thank you.
So, Lawrence, my colleagues and students, good afternoon. I'm glad to have this opportunity to share my viewpoint on national security and also to share with you some of my research findings that relate to this national corporate sustainability security issues. When I first received the invitation to talk about national security, I'm wondering what should I talk, actually. So instead of focusing on hard security issue, I suddenly come to my mind that why don't I base on my current study on the corporate sustainability performance to sound out that we should look at sustainability, particularly at the corporate level, as a security issue. So in the following times, I'd like to share with you all this kind of my new perspective to explore with you how to see, look at this security issue in terms of sustainability. Now, my objective here is can be defined as we see sustainability as a national security issue. Corporate sustainability is one of the major sources of national sustainability security. And how to conceptualize CSR, sustainability, SDG, ESG from the perspective of risk and securities. And how about the structure of national corporate sustainability security? Why matter to China? And assessing national corporate sustainability security through the index that I'm currently complying for, also complying for years, about the Greater China Business Sustainability Index, and also the how's the recent progress of sustainability performance at corporate levels that may constitute a security issue? And how about the prospect and challenge? How should we see it? So that's all the objective I'd like to achieve in this talk within 45 minutes. So first of all, let me focus on sustainability and national security to briefly to conduct a conceptual explorations. So, actually, I found that sustainability has increasingly approached from a national security perspective rather than a soft issue as a management problem. So this is the way we do it. So one thing I like to to consider is that what differentiates risk and security? Risk, according to conceptual definition, is less certain. It's an assumption that there is certain kind of risk that need to manage. Security issue is more a factual existence already. So in this perspective, I consider that sustainability is already a well-established issue for all nations to concern. And corporate sustainability, why matter? Because corporate actually contributes a major part for the security, sustainability problems. So, and sustainability, another development is that it's more from environmental to triple bottom line to SDGs. So originally the concept of sustainability in the 1987 in the Earth Summits focused almost exclusively on environment. But later on, there's a lot of contention that we should not just focus on environment. Social and economic is also important. So this is why they broaden the issue to this, we call it triple bottom line, environment, social, and economics. So I think this is why. And then later on, UN announced the importance of SDG, social sustainable development goal. But this is a national goal in contradiction with the more corporate level goal. So this is why we look at economic, environment, and social, alongside with the 7 SDGs. The task presented before all the nation and all the corporations is how to align them together. So corporate sustainability is also from CSR to sustainability. And recently, there's a prevailing trend we talk about ESG, isn't it? Environment, social, and governance, which is a practical approach to tackle the issue of CSR and sustainability. And also from risk to security, as I mentioned, risk is may not present, but seems imminent. And security is this issue that already exists. So we can almost certain that sustainability is a security issue because it is really up there. Particularly when we look at climate issue, isn't it? It's already a security. So corporate levels, there's already, we consider currently CSR and ES risk. But security, sustainability, security risk, here we talk about national corporate linkage. Why national corporate linkage? Sustainability, SDG is a national goal, but they need a partner, country need a partner to help them to achieve sustainability. One of the major contributors, more resourceful entity is corporation. So this is why corporate can help to do it. But at the same time, corporate is also a source of the problem. So this is why they perform two roles. National sustainability in the business sector, we can see how about the location, the locus. From at the China national level, sustainability, security, there are three sectors or three domains that are relevant, that constitute the national level sustainability, security. The public sector, the business sectors, and social sectors. But here, I would like to focus your attention on the business sectors because they are the partner. At the same time, they are the source of problem. So I'd just like to quickly review with you China's sustainability pathway from environment to SDGs. Environmental sustainability didn't start in China, very in a straightforward manner. There's a tortuous road pathway that China has pursued from before they entrenched on sustainability pathway. So when Deng Xiaoping's leadership from 1978 to 1989, they pursued away its pollution domination path. That means pollution should not be considered in the economic development. Then during Zhang Zhu's leadership, Jiang Zemin, so in the period before 1989 and 2002, they start to control it, but in a more passive way. So they look, they consider that, they start to consider that pollution is a threat already. In the Wu Jintao, Wen Jiabao leadership period, 2003 to 2012, they become more aggressive, more progressive, active stewardship. They try to steer away from pollution mode of productions. Then in the bring of, in the era of President Xi, then since 2013, is proactive regeneration. What do you mean by proactive regeneration? On the other hand, they take a proactive measures to stop the problems and also try to be more positive, to recover, to achieve ecological recovery. So this is why they have this kind of national goal of ecological civilization, an eco-centric value of ecological regenerations. So the focus was on regeneration instead of merely protection or conservation. And also, they start to consider SDG as the core mission of the state, enshrined in the China's national plan on implementation of 2013 Agenda for Sustainability Development in 2016, only 1 year after the UN announced the SDGs and the national duty to do it. Then they start to build a sustainability governance, integrated economic progress, ecological recovery, and social well-being. So this one well on the way along the triple bottom line conceptualizations. So we can summarize China's changing perspective from environmental to ecological governance, and later to more SDG type of perspective, triple bottom line. I don't repeat anymore. So corporate sustainability security has emerged against this background, a national strategic issue in China. We can see that China's national commitment to sustainability, to sustainable development, began since UN Conference on Environmental and Development in 1992. From then on, you can see that there's a clear roadmap and the development direction that China become more aggressive and more favor of a ecological friendly development. And later on, a national strategy to integrate all of them together. So from environment to more triple bottom line, inclusive social and economic as an integrated whole. So let's take a closer look. And how about the major aspect of sustainability of business organization at the corporate level? You can see that economic risk security, about corporate sustainability governance, sustainable investment, sustainable consumptions, and the value chain management. Social risk and security, about inclusion, employee wellness, community well-being, culture and heritage conservation, community and sustainability policies. How about the core risk, environmental security? Well, you can see that water and energy, they all can be separated as a individual dimension of security. Waste, air, land, biodiversity, and marine, the list can be longer. But I just raised the major risk there. When see that the structure of national corporate sustainability security, why? Corporate levels sustainability security issue matter in China because China is basically a socialist economy. Nearly all the enterprise under government regulation, particularly there is a large SOE sector that in the hand of the government. So that means the government has the responsibility to manage these corporations, to steer them towards sustainable development path. You can see that SOE properly, you can account for and 30% of the economic output and employment rate of 15%, whereas the market-oriented business just remain a small portion. Particularly in the recent developments, we can see that China's more favor on the state controls enterprise sectors for the promotion of common prosperities. So this is the China's sustainability pathway in the business sectors, this profile, from risk to governance to security. And top-down policy and regulation are the major driver of pushing sustainability issue forward in China. We can see that my research showed that China has increasingly tightened up the control of enterprise pollutions. But at the same time, most of the China's sustainability policies also target and business corporation because while they are the engine for economic and social well-being, they are also an environmental threat. So China government has imposed stricter sustainability disclosure standards for SOE and financial institutions. So, and because increasingly industrial pollution a core issue, China has already ordered all the listed company have to make environmental disclosure annually. But later on in the recent development is that environmental disclosure is not enough. Try to align with international practice that they have CSR, ESG disclosure as well. Although still not a mandatory measure, but will become a mandatory one. So, but China is still emphasized more on providing incentive than restraint. China like to see the possibility of using green finance to promote corporate innovation for pursuing a green path, a more sustainable path. So this is to help you to recapture China's sustainability pathway in the business sector. So in the early periods after the reopening policy since 1979, so focus on economics. So economic priority that can sacrifice the environment. So, and then later on, try to balance economic growth and environmental protection. Already there emerged the sustainability ideas in 1992 to 2007. Then later on, sustainability ideas become more sophisticated. Economics, environment, and social issue, they all consider in a holistic manner. The latest development is that eco priority. So economic development no longer is the sole purpose. They should also look at environmental, ecological well-being, and all the social issues. So this is why China undersea raised the policy direction, strategic direction, that on one hand, ecological civilizations, and then common prosperity, isn't it? So I think that's not solely on the economic growth dimension. While we all understanding economic growth is important, but that's not the way China or the people would like to do, particularly in current stage of development. People has become very alert of their environmental quality and also their life quality, instead of pure economic growth. So, this is the national business sustainability governance regime that I have tried my best to craft out. So try to make it more tidy. You can see that the regime type of China has already determined that Communist Party of China and the State Council are at the core of these governance systems. Sustainable development and business sustainability are overall planned by the State Council at the national levels. And then running down, you can see that it cut across many ministries that are responsible and committee that are responsible for economic, social, and also environmental development. So I think this is all. It's basically a state-led top-down governance systems. Separation function, of course, also allow local initiative. So this is the preliminary shape. I suppose it's still developing. It's not yet fully institutionalized, but given that sustainability governance is also a new issue in China. So you can see that so the business sustainability governance regime with the focus, they also have we can still map out an institutional arrangement that promotes corporate sustainability development. So we may take a look at the national business sustainability governance regimes. So what is it about? So the focus of attentions, you can see that regulation or control, is the business organizations. Whether it can be SOE, it can be private enterprise, joint venture, or foreign companies. So there are a few dimensions we can look at. We can start with the policy law to establish social welfare systems more on the social dimension, and law and regulation on environmental protection system, on labor force. This is more on the human resource term. So you can see that there are legal regime is there to help the business sector to be on the track of sustainable development. So under the big pictures of common prosperities. So they not only use the command and control regulation-based instrument, they also use economic and market instruments. For example, total target planning instrument, fit-in target tariff policy instruments, cost-sharing policy instrument, and tax preference policy instrument. They are all economic and market ties, indicating that China, in its arsenals for achieving sustainability, not just depending on the command and control regime. So another major instrument is to raise people's and corporate consciousness about the sustainability issues. So this is, we call it communications instruments, communication between government and business organizations, and also communication that facilitate policy implementations. So this is to make communication to raise awareness is also an important dimension that make people aware. So that the pressure may not always come from the government, can come from the society and the public to steer enterprise towards a more sustainable operations. So as I mentioned that China, the first step to tighten corporate sustainable security is to make it mandatory for those listed company, for a company to have their environmental disclosure. This is the framework that we can see about corporate environmental disclosure, how it organized and how it conducted. And this is another major instrument is to use green finance development in China. Because everyone knows that the investment on environmental protection, particularly the industrial pollution control, is very expensive. So how to get the money and how to assure the money that will go to green projects. So this is why China established a national guide green finance arrangement so that enterprise can get the funding support and also have a more project focus to lift their environmental performance through technological innovations mostly. So another market instrument is this is the based on the polluter pays principles. This is carbon trading in China. Actually, emission trading in China is not unknown. In the past, China's already established a emission trading system in China, focusing mostly on SO2 and NOx. Yeah, and practiced for a number of years, for almost decades. And although we all said that they are administrative organized instead of market oriented, like most of the Western countries in Europe, EU, and US, but they have achieved some of the purpose of reducing industrial emissions and make the environment cleaner. So, and from environmental or social or economic sustainability, China also moved towards SDG. China actually is one of the countries that are very aggressive, very progressive to support UN initiative. So, progressive, so supportive that they announced China subscribed to SDG in 2016 and at the same time established a whole list of measures, ask individuals, locality to perform it. Then, most important of all, we all know that if we just instruct the city or the provincial government to do it, it won't guarantee success. So this is why they take a step forward to establish a progressive assessment of the DG goal to assess individual locality in terms of their performance in achieving SDG, and they have an index already. So that detail individual cities' performance in SDG in a certain period of time. I don't know. I don't think they do it every year, but they do it every 5 years at this stage. So so this is why you have the first report, China's progress report on implementation of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development in 2020. So this is the first release monitoring report on the progress. So start on this, I try. So that's all about the background that China moved from national sustainability to more corporate focus. So, and then I'd like to share with you my research on it. This is the conceptualization of my conceptualization of sustainability using a stakeholder perspective and the triple bottom line approach. So as Lawrence very kind to introduce, I have been engaged in promoting CSR as a business model for corporation to achieve long-term sustainability. So this is why I consider it is still a core. You may ask me, ESG, well, how about ESG? ESG is just a way to an approach to practice CSR, because CSR is too broad to achieve. So there are three dimensions of sustainability: economic, environment, and socials. This is triple bottom line concept. And each domain, you have a set of stakeholders. In the economic dimension, you have customer, investors, suppliers, and competitors. Social dimension, you have employees, community, and government. Environment is the natural environment. There are only one stakeholder. Actually, the natural, you may ask me, natural environment cannot speak for themselves. Sometimes they can speak for, actually, through extraordinary weather. But their spokesman is ENGO, environmental non-governmental organizations. So this is the SDGs, 17 SDG, 169 targets for country to achieve, to make the world, not only the country more sustainable, but the world more sustainable. As I mentioned, that it's a national level goal. So, but you can see that goal number 17, they prescribe that there's a partnership for the goal. So the logical partner for achieving sustainability is business enterprise, isn't it? They are the problem, and they are the core entity that have the ability to help to support the country to pursue sustainability. So recently, you can see that a lot of companies, they try to align with their sustainability program with SDG. Yeah. So they may not be able to contribute all, but they will do it selectively. So this is the whole, I try to reconcile, I try to integrate all this current concept, CSR, SDGs, and sustainability, ESG together, so that we can look at them as a coherent whole. They are not conflicting. They are actually complementary with each other. So you can tidy up with the framework, just I mentioned, in the three aspect of sustainability, social, economic, and environmental sustainability. You can neatly put all the SDG into the framework. So how about our index? Because I like to assess, to present with you some of my findings in the assessing sustainability at the corporate level, their performance, based on my compilation of business sustainability index. So we compile business sustainability index on an annual basis. So it's an annual CSR performance assessments. So we factor the performance of the company in the specific years. So we adopt a VPI model, which I will introduce. It's a, we have a comprehensive assessment framework that focuses on value, process, impact, aspect of a corporate sustainability management. And we look at sustainability from a stakeholder perspective. And we base on open information, sustainability report, ESG report. Why? You may say that, why are you based on public information? Because we encourage transparency. We encourage public communications between the company and all the stakeholders. Just a brief introduction of our assessment framework, the VPI models. It is an assessment scheme of and management frameworks. Most important of all, it creates a learning and tuning mechanism to adjust corporate stakeholder management tactics by creating a value, process, impact, performance, and feedback loop. So the logic is that every company to start to consider their sustainability positioning, their mission and vision, strategy, and to sum up as a value. Then once you got the strategic values to position, then you need to translate into action. You come to the process. It drives the process. The process with two dimensions. One is you need an institutional structure to do it, to implement. Then the second part is project. You need projects to cater, to care, to be responsible to individual stakeholders. Then after the implementation, you need to assess the achievement, the impact on individual stakeholders. So you can't take it for granted. Everything you do for the well-being of individual stakeholders, that must achieve, produce possible impacts. A good example is that most of us are teachers here and you are students. As a teacher, I try my best to cultivate our students. I consider that I've done my best part. But when we ask the students, it may not be the same. Either they said that we are too strict, too much homework, too difficult to study, isn't it? So always the gap, we need to get the gap analysis. This is why we have ETs, teaching evaluation, so that we can get some feedback for continuous improvement. We all know that sustainability cannot be achieved once and for all. It is an ongoing process. We can gradually achieve, not only at the national level, but also at the enterprise level. So this is a virtuous cycle that increasingly to produce cumulative effect for well-beings. So I don't repeat, it's value post, so this is the framework we adopt. So actually, how about the score to implement? You said because the assessment scheme always produces a score, like our teaching, isn't it? When students submit assignment to us, we all have a score. So what's the score means? We try to spread out six tiers of the score to show their level of achievements. So below 50, we describe it as explorer, then practitioner, performer, achiever, pace, sector, and that the higher level of achievement is exemplified. That means they are close to a perfect model for other company to learn. So six tiers. So Greater China, so the flagship index we currently have is the Greater China Business Sustainability Index. We start doing it from 2020. So we have 2 years data for me to share with you. But some backgrounds. Actually, we start the Business Sustainability Index that do with SME day back to 2012. And we experiment another index is for the listed company, Hong Kong Business Sustainability Index, that include all the Hang Seng constituent company into our index. So we launched it in 2015, but we broadened it to Greater China in 2020 after we accumulate enough experience. So you can see that for the Greater China Business Sustainability Index, actually there are four sub-index we can identify. First of all is the Hong Kong one, Hong Kong BSI. The other one is the Taiwan BSI. And then we have Shanghai and Shenzhen. Because each of these locations have a stock exchange, they have their own set of listed company and their own set of listed company. You can see that the percentage, of, I indicated a OE percentage to see their locus, because we all know that SOE owned by the Chinese government, and they are always a problem of sustainability. So that you can see that in Taiwan, there's not many SOE, but in Shanghai and Shenzhen, you can see that quite a substantial amount of numbers. And in Hong Kong also, we have a lot of SOE. Actually, we have a lot of non-local China-based company in the Hang Seng Index. So this is table sum up their performance, actually. How should we look at it? This is the our 2020 and 2021 data. You can see that Greater China Index, the score, one of the attention I like to draw is that you can be a little bit relaxed, because all the company have made improvements. So the overall score has improved from 46 to 51. If we use the 59, 50 as the definitive 9 for sustainability and unsustainability, you can see that only in the impact dimension that they haven't done, they haven't able to cross the 59. That means they are all have doing impressive, particularly in the practice dimension. They have done better in practice than management, than values, than impact, actually. Impact is that firm have been delayed to assess their performance, their gap of performance. So I think this is somewhere a management issue. It's not only common in China, but also company listed in Hong Kong as well, Taiwan as well. They all score low in impact. They don't have their data about how good they have performed. So I differentiate key KPI from KII. We use KII. You may ask me how to differentiate KPI and KII. We use impact. Sometimes some KPI actually are KII, but I may not be able to give you a perfect definition, but I can give you a perfect differentiation. Ourselves as an academic, we publish the number of papers every year or every few of times. So number of papers is KPI. But not all papers are impactful. Some are cited and some are rarely cited, isn't it? So the impact in the citation is the impact indicator. So we have performance and impact. So you can see that from the first three stakeholders, investor, customer, and supplier, they belong to the economic domain, isn't it? According to the triple bottom line, you can see that actually Shanghai and Shenzhen are quite worried about us, although make progress still under 50 benchmark. Yeah, that means they haven't met do the economic sustainability well. About environments, about employee, community, government, this is the social dimensions. So they are good to manage, perform better to manage the employee and also to follow governments, to support the government, but not necessarily serve community well. So I think that means that the missing link here is the community well value of the company has yet to improve. How about environment? You can see that both environments, they have improved, but way, way behind the 50 mark lines. So that means their environmental sustainability have not been progressing well, though improving. So this is from so in aggregate, we can see that Taiwan on the whole, they need the lead tables. So overall performance improving, but the pecking order is still there. Taiwan, Hong Kong, Shanghai, Shenzhen. So that's the order as a whole. But you don't need that table may relieve your pleasure that actually Hong individual performance, Hong Kong company perform better than Taiwan company. But on average, not that the case. So you can see that the top 10 ranking company in our BSI, seven of them are Hong Kong-based company. So only three are Taiwan. But another missing aspect is that the mainland, the China-based company have yet to break into the top 10. That means on the whole, their sustainability performance is quite well behind. So the security issue is not a risk, it's an actual issue there, corporate. So this is take a closer look and China launch China-based firm in Hong Kong BSI. You can see that you can argue that those listed in Hong Kong are more advanced, but still, in comparison with Hong Kong-based company, they are still left behind. Although they are the unique company in China, like Tencent, like China Mobile. So actually, if you look at from the positive side, the range of improvements, actually China and Hong Kong and Taiwan firm, their improvement has been very marginal. But the improvement of those companies in China and in Taiwan, they are more visible. I think that's natural because their baseline is slower and they are on the way of catching up. So impact assessment, as I mentioned, that they're all company, no matter in which jurisdiction, they are all slow in setting up a good assessment management systems to find out how good they perform. So I think this is, of course, firm in China particularly weak there. So another dimension I'd like to share with you is the hotel sector, because we also released the Greater China Hotel BSI 2 years ago alongside with the Greater China one. You can see that out of all the performance, the hotel sector performs is quite, on the whole, not that well in comparison with the overall performance. The worst case, of course, is China. They only improve very little in the in the gap years, yeah. And they also perform very lowly in the lead table. So so we can sum up that Taiwan-based improves victories, but mainland China still struggling on that. There's two poles of it. So let me conclude by looking at the way forward. Governing national corporate sustainability security. What is the current situation and how should we lift the performance to improve the systems? So in the business sustainability governance regimes, we can see that they're already in place, rules and regulations, policy support. Policy support including sustainable finance, sustainable development education, market incentives, and financing support. They also rely on communication to raise the awareness and knowledge sharing. Government needed training program and dialogues or policy interpretation. They try to communicate clearly the policy intents to individual enterprise. And then they Also, this is the existing governance regime that probably still developing. We hope that they will eventually, gradually build up their institutional strength, they achieve better performance. What can be done to improve the performance? There are a few we can see that. I consider that I have once proposed the National Corporate Sustainability Security Index so that we can keep track of the level of corporate performance and the level of the problems. And then we have the National Corporate Sustainability Rating and Certification Scheme. Each company in China, be it whether it's listed or not listed, should have a ESG or sustainability rating every year so that we know we can track the performance. Then company will take it more seriously. Of course, we should have regulations to promote corporate sustainability governance, because that's the core of the issue. The starting point. Each company should have a well-established corporate governance for pursuing sustainabilities, whether it's NIST or non-NIST, SOE or non-SOE, and domestic or international companies. Then we come to the capacity building. How good the company can achieve it? Today, all of a sudden, we find that each company, they are shortage of ESG or sustainability people, expert to do it. So cultivate sustainability ESG challenge is an urgent task. And this is why Chinese Shoe Business School is already set to launch this MSc program in global sustainability business, hopefully in next academic years. Then finally, China need to align with the international about global corporate sustainability orientation. Don't look at it only at the national level internally. We need to align with the international practice. We all know that China, in terms of corporate sustainability, is still lagging behind the international practice. We hope that China will, in the forthcoming years, achieve better, and hopefully it can reflect in our sustainability index. So thank you for your patience. That's I would like to share all with you, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Lo, for that stimulating discussion. And I'm very pleased to advise that Professor Lo has kindly agreed to spend a few minutes in dialogue with our participants today. And we've got, I think, around 20 plus people joining us online. So if you'd like to ask a question online, then please feel free to input your questions in the Q&A box. And of course, for those of us here in the real world, please feel free to raise your hand. And I think Tim Summers.
Thank you very much, Professor Lo, for a very interesting lecture. My question follows up a little bit from your very last point. I wanted to ask you how an open and internationally connected economy can use that global engagement to enhance national corporate sustainability security. You know, what? Perhaps put the question in another way, what are the implications of degrees of openness of an economy for maintaining national corporate sustainability security? Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, I think China has long set it as the major objective to re-enter into the international economy, international market. And then there are many companies that are listed in the stock exchange in many Western countries. And they need to reach this standard. And also, my teaching experience in China told me that this corporate management, they are very ambitious, try to break into the Forbes 500, isn't it, their company, to make their company. So in doing that, you just try not to focus on profit side, but also you need to focus on their corporate performance in environmental and also in social dimension, because all these issues are taken very seriously in EU and increasingly in China, in the US. So in order to compete with this Western company at the international level, they need to align with the international standard orientation about ESG sustainability. Otherwise, it's difficult for you to take an active part
and take a share of the your business in the at the international level. So I think this is what China tried to become an economic power in terms of their enterprise strength. I think that's the pleasure at the same time the motivation. Thank you.
Yes, hello.
Thank you very much, Professor Lo. I'm Jin Shen from Department of Sociology. So I also have a little project about the sociology and the sociology of law in this regard. So I feel very impressed and very inspired by your amazing project for many, many years. Actually, you published dozens papers in this regard. And you basically are also a great example to show us how to study corporate sustainability and Chinese government policy in this regard, and how to make impact, social impact, in a tremendous way. So you are basically a great model for us. So I learned a lot from your presentation today, particularly the conclusion part, like, so we need to pay the attention that not limited to listing companies, but those non-listing companies, we should definitely give them those mechanisms to basically help them to have the incentive, and basically this mechanism try to encourage them to do more. So my particular question is, given that, for example, if we look into what China did in the past 10 years, and basically document the past four in the landscape of the past four decades, what they did amazingly in the past 10 years in so many ways that possibly 10 years ago we cannot believe Beijing can do so much so impressively to really promote the environment. Then my question is, what we can learn to promote like climate change, right? We have the Paris Agreement. So what lessons and experience we can learn from the environment governance to the future, say climate change governance, what we can do to make the Paris Agreement into something real, to be, you know, forceful. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that's a very good question. I remember that there's always a debate about why China developed faster than Russia, both after the drastic changes in regime time, Russia. Soviet Union fell in 1989, and China have a rise from the disastrous Cultural Revolution. Why China can move faster in terms of development than Russia? We need to go back to the regime type. So in a development trajectory, I consider that at the development stages, China still in the development stages. I think a strong stay in it approach, a strong stay with a clear purpose will be the necessary institution to make the country forward, progress. Like sustainability issue is more or less top down because of conflict of interest, there are too many conflict of interest, they should or even favor a non-sustainable way of doing things. So you have too many conflicting interests to reconcile, too much to handle for a democratic procedures. So you need to have a clear process. So like what I have already advocated, even in a company, at the corporate level, sustainability, environmental issue must be a top down before it can be bottom up. So I think, so you can see that probably underline what I have said, China is almost the first major country that responds positively to SDG, to UN's SDG, and quickly make a explicit arrangement to support that, to assign, to impose from the top that every jurisdiction have to do it. And we set up a monitoring system and they report the finding, how each city, each major jurisdiction perform, and they rank it. And I don't know whether they punish or they reward those government officials, but increasingly they try to reward those government officials. They handle the sustainability issue well. So I think it's top-down mode is important, particularly for in a strong stay mode, they may move things faster. While all other countries can see that they are still debating. How should they do it, isn't it? Whether to support, even if they support, they haven't sort out a way to do it. So in this dimension, in the issue, I think China's system has indicated its strength. Not everyone welcome that top-down and also reconcile interest in the way of that favor the nation's direction, I think. But in terms of this particular sustainability security issue, I think China have enjoyed this regime-type superiority. How to carry other conflicting interests, I think is something China government need to consider, I suppose. Hopefully it can eventually develop a national culture so that it can be transformed from a top down to a more bottom up or more decentralized mode of operations. Thank you.
Yeah, I think the point that you made about the SDG city report is a powerful one for exactly the reasons that you've just mentioned. And as I was listening to you share the results of your business sustainability index and looking at the performance of mainland companies relative to those in Hong Kong and Taiwan, I thought you've actually got an enormous business opportunity here through your index. You must have been speaking to mainland government authorities and also different stock markets and other people that have an interest in this, because if we can take your BSI and make that the equivalent in a corporate governance context, it would become the gold standard in terms of transparency for how the Chinese corporate world is responding to sustainability. I mean, you must be thinking actively about how to take this into the mainland in a big way.
Yeah, we have been communicating with the Chinese government how to set up a system like that based on our model. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're correct. I think that China's need stronger institutional mechanism to steer the corporate in the sustainability directions. Mm-hmm. That's a good idea, Joe.
And we live and breathe this in university world as well. We have people like Cecilia and Eric who worry about our performance in Times Higher Education Impact Ranking, the new sustainability component of the QS World University Rankings. And so these are things that suddenly mean that universities have to think differently about how they approach the SDGs. So I think that if you can get that type of culture moving into the business world to help companies really think about this, it'd be a terrific way forward. Do we have any other questions from the floor? I can't see any that have come through online. Yes.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Low, for your really insightful and enlightening talk. And my question is, so I think the Chinese sustainability governance regime is really, as you have articulated so beautifully, it's kind of a hybrid regime, right? So on the one hand, it's sort of a top-down, more traditional administrative means. On the other hand, there are market, economic incentives, and also communication channels. So I'm wondering to what extent are there tensions, like incoherence, or complementarities, right? So among these different types of channels or tools in achieving sustainability security, right? So and what can be done to address this kind of tensions or sort of potential weaknesses in the governance regime in order to enhance its performance?
Yeah, I think that that's a very difficult question to answer, because I think that's how the governance regime should go. I think that's it. There's always a debate whether should be command and control dominance, supported by market economic instruments, based on long-term development, or long-term communication approach. I think this is how we mix with it, and also how far this should be top-down, or how far local autonomy should be respected, because China is so diverse a nation, it's difficult to have one solution for all. So how far we should respect it. So, and then we giving too decentralized, that may lose they may have the danger of loss of control. But if too centralized, that may make some individual jurisdictions suffer because they may not have the resources to do it. I think how to do a balance is very important. But I consider that when we take this issue into consideration, the most important of all is that China should have a very clear strategic positioning in sustainability, security issues, and then set up a more coherent governance framework, because it's too fragmented, as you have mentioned, that may not have the center control. How the division of work between central and local levels, and also to cater on the regional diversity. I think this is all the issues that need to it. Also different type of regime, different type of enterprise. How should we cater for? I think this is, if you put it this way, then the issue is more complicated than we understand and we can quickly solve. So this is why sustainability, also not to mention that sustainability security is an ongoing issue. And I suppose, I always said that sustainability is our human being problem for the next 50 decades, we still maintain face this sustainability issue. So how should we achieve it step by step through innovation, technological innovation, and management innovation? I think when we go to this complexity, I suppose I need to work with all of you to find a good way to do it. Not solution, but a way to do it.
Yeah, it's interesting. I don't think I've heard the words sustainability and security used together in quite the same context that you have today. Mm-hmm. But I suspect that if sustainability can be elevated into the language of 国家安全层面, then I'm sure that that lots more decisive action will be taken. And with that, I do believe that we are at time. Please join me once again in thanking the fabulous Professor Carlos Lo for his stimulating discussion this afternoon. And thank you all for coming. Thank you.
Thank you, all of you. Thank you, all of you. Thank you, all of you.